Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is December 10th, 2017. This is the second Sunday of Advent. Pastor Pollock is away today. We have Pastor Carol Gesselman as our guest pastor. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has a midweek service on Wednesday at 6:30 in the chapel, a half-hour service with communion. On December 24th, Christmas Eve, our morning service will be combined. It's the cantata, the 8 o'clock and 10:30 service will be at 9:30. There'll be a continental breakfast at 8 o'clock before the service.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your word and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
the way of your Holy Son. By his coming, strengthen us to serve you with purified lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 40. Comfort, oh comfort, my people.
Wait a second. We're going to like the advent. Something new. Thank you.
Come on, Tyler.
Debbie and Mike Cochran will be lighting the Advent wreath. Jackson will do the reading.
The first reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 4. Comfort, oh comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms, and carry them in his bosom, and gently lead the mother sheep.
Thanks be to God. Becky Dimitroff for the song.
And second reading this morning is from 2 Peter chapter 3. Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promises, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze in the salt, and the elements will melt with fire. But in accordance with this promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as salvation.
The Gospel Acclamation.
Thank you.
straight in the desert a highway. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. I blame the automobile. I think cars are the reason that we cannot connect with this passage. I mean, what do we care what kinds of hills and valleys lie between us and our destination? We just hop in the car and take off. We've got struts and shock absorbers, front-wheel drive, and even four-wheel drive, some of us. We have a good set of tires, and before long, we're there. The uneven ground's already been leveled. It's been dynamited down or filled up with dirt. I mean, when was the last time you drove by a marker along the highway that declared you'd reached such and such an elevation? I'll bet you weren't even out of breath. Of course, it can be different when you get off the interstates. Of course, you still have the struts and everything that make it nice, a pleasant drive, but I once served the church in Baden, Pennsylvania, where, unlike Ohio, the streets can be very, very steep. And the street on which the people lived that I was going to visit was so steep that I was actually afraid to park my car on it. So I parked on the level street, which was perpendicular to it, and then walked up to their house, which walking up wasn't too bad. But it was when I left their house and needed to walk down that steep hill that I was really afraid that I was going to slip on the loose gravel and slide on down the whole way. So keep that image of steep hills and slippery gravel in your mind as you start to think about what Isaiah was picturing when he wrote of highways. You see, the streets and roads of Isaiah's day weren't like our roads. There was no pavement, and no cars, of course. Secondly, they were carved on the sides of steep hills, winding around and over the terrain. No direct path for them. And yet, ancient Israel was right along the pathway between Asia and Africa. It was part of the Fertile Crescent that wrapped itself around the Syrian desert. Caravans passed through Israel daily, heading north to Syria and beyond, and then around and south to Egypt. Going through Israel was the only way to get there. There were three main roads going north and south. One coastal, that's this way for you, and two inland, with many roads going out from them heading east and west. Travel was by foot or with a donkey, rarely by horse or camel. Loads could be carried by cart, but it was quite difficult. And of course, we need to remember that along with caravans and local farmers, these curvy, twisty roads were used by armies on their way to conquer countries. From Persia and Babylonia to the east, for example, armies would swing to the north into Syria, around the desert, and then march through Israel. March through Israel toward Egypt to the south. Time and again, the people of Israel and Judah would be overrun, conquered, and carried off into captivity, setting them up for the long road back to freedom when and if the opportunity came. So this imagery of roads that God uses through Isaiah speaks to the captives and carries with it the reality of their homeland lost and of being far from home. There is, for the Israelite, a sense of despair that sets the stage for the hope that Isaiah promises, or that God promises through Isaiah. The prophet speaks of mountains being brought down and valleys raised up. Now that would have only happened take this imagery and reintroduce it, using Isaiah's words, but clearly speaking of spiritual realities rather than a physical reality. The words that John the Baptizer spoke would be understood as referring to the unevenness of people's lives and the rough places in their hearts. The call to prepare a way for God would be a call to change their lives. The Messiah was coming. That's where God's words through Isaiah speak to us today, especially in this season of Advent. Aren't we always being called on to consider our life's journey at this time of the year? Who among us couldn't talk about the rough places we've seen? Who sitting here hasn't negotiated their way down deep descents afraid of sliding down, or struggled to make it up and over high barriers? Can we talk about when and where and how it is that our lives have been taken into captivity? And confess about the hunger that rises up within us to find our way back home? Whether home is being in God's good graces, or whether it means our heavenly home. When you think about those times when the road back to God seemed like a long and hard way, maybe even impossible, does Isaiah's poetic language touch you? When the hurt has welled up in your soul, have you been moved to think about an easy road back? A road not blocked by high peaks or deep canyons? Advent is the season to prepare for our Messiah's coming. In the manger, in our minds, and in glory at the very end. Such a preparation requires that we struggle, that we spend time climbing over barriers and fighting our way through temptation, that we get in touch with our sinfulness and our need for the Savior. Such a preparation for Jesus' coming means that we need to be more aware of our own need, that we face the fact that one day we will die, and that we come to know how much we need the one who is coming and is ever coming, our Messiah, our Savior. Such a preparation requires that we be willing to repent, to change, to live as God wants. Our preparation is a time of struggle, but also a time for hope. It is time to be comforted by a prophet who assures us that as hard as it all may be, it will not be impossible. There is a way. And the one who even now is waiting to welcome us has prepared the way for us and will help us to get there, no matter how difficult the road. There was a seminary professor I knew who told of his first day in algebra class. It was his second year of the subject, but he just could not seem to get it. He was paralyzed with fear, and his stomach seemed as if it were bouncing up and down on a trampoline. A new teacher walked in, looked a lot like the old teacher. She was holding a book that looked a lot like last year's book. Before the class began, he thought he'd go up to the teacher and explain to her what a dunce he was with algebra. So when he confessed his troubles, she didn't seem to care. She said, that may be true, but that was before you had me as your teacher. You are going to find that I do things differently. I don't like to get students who have done well with algebra before they have me. Too many prejudices. I prefer getting people who don't know a lot about algebra so I can teach them from scratch. The student went back to his seat and breathed a sigh of relief. It was a new beginning, and he could change with the help of his teacher. That's the good news of Jesus Christ. We can change. We can become new, loving, hopeful, joyful. we can do it through the transforming power of Jesus Christ and the ever-present Holy Spirit. And so we say, come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. Give
me God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us come before the Lord with true hearts, trusting that he will hear and answer our prayers on behalf of the church, the world, and all people according to their need. Heavenly Father, prepare your church for the coming of your Son. From valleys of lukewarm worship and half-hearted service, raise it to heights of praise and compassion. Level mountains of false teaching and self-importance and lead it along level pathways of faithfulness and humility so that many may journey to your kingdom. Help us, Lord, to be inviting to others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Be merciful to our persecuted brothers and sisters who proclaim the name of Jesus even amidst their enemies. Make their witness to shine as a light in the world's darkest places, and pierce the hearts of their tormentors with the truth of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Prepare the people of this congregation for the coming of our Savior. Help us to exalt the humble, to bring low the mountains of self-will in our lives, to make level pathways for leading others to Jesus. Look with favor upon our sister congregations, and upon your missionaries around the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Prepare the hearts of our children for the coming of their dear Savior. Protect and bless them, and help us teach them to love Jesus and to trust him always. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Prepare the hearts of first responders and military personnel for the coming of the King of Peace. Raise up every deed which brings safety to dangerous places. Level mountains of suspicion and understanding, and lead those we pray for along level pathways to their homes and loved ones. We pray especially, Lord, for the people who are fighting the fires in California. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Prepare the hearts of those who suffer from the coming of Christ, the great physician. Pray especially for Ann's, Brandon, Jennifer, Mike, Whitey, Julie, and all those who are ill or in need of your help that we do not know about. Raise them up from sickness and sorrow. Lay low the mountains of pain, and by your Son's gentle hand, lead them and their loved ones along level pathways into health and hope. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, we thank you for keeping in your tender care all who have died, trusting in your promises. Prepare our hearts for the near approach of our Savior, who raises us up from death's dark valley, who brings down the mountains of your wrath at our sins, and who leads us along level roads of faith, hope, and love into your welcoming and eternal embrace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Graciously answer our prayers according to the love you bear for your people through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
We shall now gather in your offering.
Thank you.
for your word of life, O God.
We give you thanks and praise.
By your word, you called our people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God.
We give you thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness. Forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God.
We give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God. Rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom as we pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. Thanks be to God.
This concludes our service.
It's appropriate for today.
Thank you for watching our service on YouTube. The flowers on the altar are given by Bob, Fred, and Mick Mitterholzer in remembrance of Margaret and Fred Mitterholzer at Christmas, and Les and Cindy Pearson and family in memory of Bill DeSellum on his birthday. St. John's has a thrift store, which is open Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1. Closed on Thursday. Food pantry is every Wednesday from 9 to 10:45. Wednesday night midweek service is at 6:30 with communion in the chapel.